Ladies and gentlemen, and boys and girls, if you would please stand. Ready to go. And our first musical prelude is Eric and Nicole Held. Excuse me.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me. I will give you rest. If you pass through raging waters in the sea, you shall not drown. If you walk amid the burning flames, you shall not be harmed. If you stand before the power of hell and death is at your side, know that I am with you through it all. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest.
Thank you. Please be seated. My name is Val Grant. Well, sometimes I go by that name. Today I'm going to do that. I would like now, as we are all in here, is that would everybody just close their eyes for just a moment? Oh no, I have one more announcement before you close your eyes. Oh, I almost forgot that one. Please turn off your cell phones. With eyes closed, I would like you to think of Jim's smile, his laughter, his jokes. Just bring that image into your mind. And with that in mind, we are here to celebrate the life of James Anderson. And in so doing, I want to start off with a little story that happened just recently. A nurse asked Jim what hospital he was in. And he said, McKay D, which is a hospital in Ogden, Utah. And he said, she said, why are you here? He said, something wrong with my lung. And she looked and said, okay. And said, do you know this lovely woman standing to your right? He looked over and he said, no. But she's been following me around for years. And that's Jim to a T. And I would like to introduce Eric Sawyer, who will give a eulogy And please, Eric.
I think many of you know me, but for those of you who don't, I'm Eric Sawyer, and I'm married to Jim and Ginger's daughter, Lynn. Do you all know why I'm up here today? Because Jim told me, since I was first married into the Anderson family, that I was his favorite son-in-law. Of course, at the time, I was his only son-in-law. So maybe he chose me because we shared the same middle name. I don't know. But what I do know is that he and I had a special relationship, and I'm very honored to be here today to remember and celebrate a great man. Today, I get to tell you about my favorite father-in-law. We are all blessed. Look around you. Every one of us is blessed to have been a part of Jim's, Dad's, Grandpa's life, and blessed to have him be a part of our lives. I don't know anyone who could say that having Jim in their life was anything other than a blessing. With a smile on his face, his friendly nature, and his quick wit, he was easy to warm up to and to enjoy his company. Some got 58 years with him, some got 30. Some of this new generation only got a few, but we were all blessed. James Edward Anderson was born in DeKalb, Illinois on June 13, 1937 to Arthur and Inona Anderson. He was raised in DeKalb along with his older brother, John, who was 6 years his senior. He always said that they lived in the best of times. They were outside from daylight to dark, playing down by the Kishwaukee River in their forts and on a boat that John built. As he said, it actually floated. He also visited the library a lot, and he loved to read Disney comic books. He got a job working at the DeKalb Daily Chronicle in high school and graduated from DeKalb Township High School in 1955. He loved math and business classes and was very talented with numbers. Lynn has told me stories of how he could run a 10-key adding machine with his right hand while writing and recording with his left hand simultaneously. After high school, he got a job with the Wurlitzer Piano Company as an accountant. He decided to join the Army in 1960. He was smart enough to know where he could serve and avoid being drafted and shipped off to a combat zone in the infantry. So he elected to enlist and worked in the Army's security agency at Fort Devens, Massachusetts for a few years as a company clerk. This was an important decision because it led him to a dance hall with his Army buddies in 1961, where they met a group of nursing students. Jim was the popular one in the group because his mom says he had the car. And what a beauty, a 1956 Buick convertible. Every time one of the guys had a date, they found a date too for Jim so he could drive. And one of those setups was with Ginger, and the rest is history. They were married in Bradford, Massachusetts on April 11th, 1964. He rejoined Wurlitzer after his discharge from the Army, and they settled in DeKalb, where Bobby, David, Lynn, and Kristen were born. Wurlitzer transferred him to their division in Logan in 1973, where he and Ginger settled and raised their family. After Wurlitzer closed their plant in Logan, Jim moved on to managing people and projects as a supervisor for Herff Jones Yearbooks before retiring in 1996. He never really retired, though. Jim was a fiddler. No, not like playing the violin or the cello. Maybe fidgeter would be a better description. He kept his hands busy, jingling the change in his pocket or twiddling his thumbs when they weren't busy. He kept himself busy with looking after his own house projects and projects where his kids lived. He became a well-rounded handyman who could install toilets, re-roof the house, fix a furnace, hang a ceiling fan, you name it. Lynn had always told me that her dad was a kind-hearted softie, but he tended not to show it, so she'd just go up and hug him anyway. He grew up in a family where hugs and I love yous weren't shared, but he found affection next door at his Uncle Emil and Aunt Winnie's home growing up. Emil would take him to ball games, and every Sunday he took him to the Elks Club or to the university to meet Emil's friends, making Jim feel special and loved. He loved Emil very much and passed on his name to his son. He may not have experienced a lot of demonstrations of love toward him at home, but Virginia Lee Dawkins changed that. She changed him. She showed him how to hug and how to show love. But it wasn't necessarily a fast transition for him to love me. I got a handshake, not a hug, on every visit to the Andersons over 19 years, even on our wedding day. But something happened in 2008 when Jim was diagnosed with kidney cancer. The first time I saw him after the scare, he said, "I'm not gonna kiss you, but I'll give you a hug." And he opened his arms to me. And from that moment on, he always had a hug ready. Ginger recalled recently the day when one of the triplets came running into the living room to tell her sisters, "Grandpa just gave me a hug." And immediately the other two ran off to get theirs. It was a special memory. He often shared his love by ways other than physical affection, by a simple tap on the knee or slipping a $20 bill in the hand of his kids as they were heading out the door for the evening. Jim was a jokester and he had a great sense of humor. Whether it was about my good looks or his, he loved to banter back and forth with me. And he did it all the time. His sassy sarcasm and quick wit could always make you laugh. It's a favorite story among the Anderson kids about Ginger shaking her finger while lecturing them while Dad was standing right behind her making faces to make the kids crack up. Jim was raised as a member of the Lutheran Church in DeKalb, and he attended catechism class when he was young. He was a devout Christian as an adult too, attending church at least twice a year without fail at both Christmas and Easter. In all seriousness, he was not an outwardly faithful man, but he was a man who prayed and spoke of the Lord silently. He also supported his kids and grandkids in whichever direction their faith took them. And he seemed to gain a love-hate relationship with the Catholic Church here in Logan in the latter part of his life. It seemed like every time he went there the past few years, he'd pass out and have to have the ambulance come just to make sure the devil hadn't taken him yet. We had many laughs about that one. Jim lived to the ripe old age of 84. Thinking back on the years, I was struck by the good luck he had. No knee replacements, no arthritic hip, no strokes, no back problems. But when I thought a little bit deeper about it, it struck me. Jim was really a warrior. He had 6 stents placed in his heart. He had a kidney removed due to cancer. He had a pacemaker put in. He battled congestive heart failure. And this was all before he got lymphoma and had to adapt to a radical, low salt, and to be honest, no taste diet. He even had to give up beer. So where would you find him shortly after all these medical procedures? Up where no man in his late 70s should be. Up in the tree, trimming branches, on a ladder, cleaning the gutters out, on the roof, taking care of the swamp cooler, painting the house, mowing the lawn. He fought until the very end with a courage that we can all be inspired by. He wasn't a complainer, not a woe is me guy. He kept on going, and if anything, was just frustrated that his heart and lungs weren't allowing him to do the things he wanted to be able to do. I'll tell you, he was a warrior in another way. He'd eat anything you put in front of him. Squash soup, liver, boiled onions, even food past due in the fridge. This has led to a saying in the Sawyer House when faced with some really old leftovers. WWJD, what would Jim do? Of course, he'd eat it, and he never got sick. Jim was an adventurer, too. You wouldn't know it. He didn't own a bunch of high-end camping gear or a climbing harness, but he was a closet cave explorer. He took his boys several times into Logan Cave. He made sure he took the boys fishing every year on opening day. He led the kids on hikes up the mountain behind the house, chased buffalo with them in South Dakota, and hiked in Zion when he was 80. He hiked up to Landscape Arch and to Corona Arch outside of Moab a few years ago, where he promptly passed out and then refused to let search and rescue carry him back to the parking lot, insisting he was walking out on his own. He would always be up for a camping trip with his boys in Logan Canyon, and later on in his life, he didn't mind camping as long as there was a motel next door to our campground that he could stay in. My family got to watch him experience his first s'more in his late 70s at our campfire, and that was a memorable treat. So what did Jim love? He loved Ginger, his wife, for 58 years. Like any marriage, they shared so much and made such a great team together. He was a great husband and great father. He would surprise Ginger with bluebird chocolates or flowers when she wasn't expecting it, not on Valentine's Day or her birthday, because that was too predictable. Before the day when it was more common for men to help raising kids and doing work around the house, Jim was that dad who cooked meals, cared for the kids, helped with the homework when Ginge was working night shifts as a nurse. He was a great cook with a knack for making ham and scalloped potatoes, Spanish rice, pea soup, pan-fried hot dogs split down the middle with baked beans, and chipped beef on toast. I can assure you that Lynn is not on board with calling that last one of his finest efforts. Dad loved his kids, supporting them however they needed it. Jim was able to not only give his kids a pat on the back, but also a nudge when they needed one to point them in the right direction. And his words always hit the spot. He taught important lessons, like balancing checkbooks and saving money. In his special way, he was guardian over each of his kids, always there to support them, encourage them, make sure they were taken care of, treated well, and with opportunities to be successful. When asked what things bring him peace, Jim once said, "Peace for me is when the entire family is in an okay place without problems. They're the most important people in my life, and when they are okay, I am okay." What else did Jim love? Vacationing at the lake in New Hampshire every summer. For over 50 years, Jim and Ginge were a staple at Sundeck Cottages at Lake Winnipesaukee, their golden pond. He loved to swim with the kids out to Pebble Rock, as I know all of you grandkids remember. And he loved to gab with friends for hours on the deck overlooking the lake. He loved taking family vacations because he didn't get that opportunity when he was a child. Trips to Illinois, Florida, the Grand Canyon, Yellowstone, Mount Rushmore, and Disneyland, with the kids all spread out in the back of the station wagon and Ginger making sandwiches in the back seat. He loved a nice day at Bear Lake because he could enjoy having his family with him. He loved a good game of golf. He loved a cold beer, sharing a bottle of wine and conversation with friends at Wine Group. And he loved good food, especially sweet corn in Illinois and lobster in New England. He loved family barbecues. He loved getting ice cream at Sawyer's in New Hampshire, and Aggie ice cream. He loved a night at the theater watching a play, and he loved to watch the stock market news. He loved to play the lotto. He loved to go for walks. He loved traveling in Europe. He loved going to the pool here in Logan with his kids and grandkids. He loved the annual Anderson celebration with his family. He loved to buy new cars. He loved bartering and making the deal. He loved Buicks and Cadillacs. He loved to tell stories. He loved the color red. He loved a good head and shoulder rub. He loved sitting in the sun, in the warmth. He loved cinnamon bears, and Grandpa loved his grandkids. Think about all the hours he spent driving to and from your activities and watching soccer, lacrosse, basketball, volleyball, and football games, races at the racetrack, piano recitals, choir and band concerts, awards assemblies, graduations, weddings, baptisms, first communions, and confirmations. He always made the effort to be there, even when it was really hard due to his health issues. When asked what his greatest joy was, he said, having the door open and hearing the grandchildren yell, Grandpa! And he took every one of you to share what he loved so much at Lake Winnipesaukee. Jim's parents were the part of the generation that lived through the Depression, and they saved everything. Always cost conscious. They saved money, saved newspapers, cans of food and empty plastic containers, and they shopped very frugally. They passed on their lifestyle to Jim, who would always drive around town, probably spending more money in gas than he saved in groceries, but at peace with the fact that he got a good deal on canned vegetables, cereal, bread, and hot chocolate. But with every penny he saved, he gave away a dollar or five of them in ways that no one but family knew. Supporting a girl in the Philippines who'd lost her parents, buying a stove for the priest or a fridge for the church, supporting the Special Olympics. The list goes on, yet he never shared these deeds for notoriety. He only did them because he was a kind man. There are a lot of people in this room who are benefactors of Jim's kind spirit and generosity. He lent money, fixed up your house, bought you cheap booze in Colorado, and shared wisdom and advice. He devoted time to all of us, and often his actions spoke louder than words. When the kids were little, he'd get everyone up in the car on their vacation departure day around 3 a.m. and drive a very long day just so the kids could get to the motel early and be able to play in the pool. After Ginger's father passed away, Jim continued the tradition that her dad had started by buying a box of chocolates for the whole family and placing them under the tree to share at Christmas time. It was his unspoken way of keeping his memory alive. When I broke my collarbone when our twins were 13 months old and I had to take 5 weeks off of work, he was on our doorstep the next day ready to help us out with the kids so Lynn could keep working. That was the kind of guy he was. Do you know that without fail, he brought groceries to our house in Colorado every single time he's visited since Lynn and I got married 25 years ago? I don't know what we'll do without the biannual food bank donations from Jim's charity. But now that we're in our 50s, I guess we'll have to try to make it on our own. Even last week in the hospital, he was joking in a way to make his healthcare providers feel comfortable and at ease as he was slipping away. At the very end, he was still thinking of others. As Mother Teresa once said, not all of us can do great things, but we can do small things with great love. And that was Dad. Your husband, your dad, grandpa, and friend was a beautiful, loving, caring man. What an amazing transformation from a childhood in which he didn't really feel loved in his own home to always making sure others felt loved and cared for in his warm and funny way. In this world, there are takers. Those who take your time, your money, your energy, your attention, and there are givers. Jim was a giver. Whether he gave his time to support us in our endeavors, whether it was helping a neighbor out without solicitation, supporting a church or an important cause, helping family members out or providing important advice when we needed it. He gave us his time, his talents, his treasure, and his love. He lives on in all of us, and he will never die because we can carry on his legacy, enjoy life, share warm smile, be fun loving, happy, funny, hardworking, and most of all, be a giver. In closing, I'd like to read you a poem by Linda Ellis. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears, but he said what mattered most was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that they spent alive on earth. Now only those who love them know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real, and always try to understand the way other people feel, and be less quick to anger and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read, with your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash? I think we can all agree that Jim did an amazing job with how he spent his dash. He lived well and he loved well. And now it's time to go. Home, James.
You done good, dude. Anyhow, we have I've got to find out where I am. A gospel reading by Catherine Sawyer, granddaughter.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may also be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you, Catherine. Next, we have a musical selection by Eric and Nicole Hell called On Eagle's Wings.
Raise you up on eagle's wings.
There you are, the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings. Bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. No thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings. Bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. And hold you in the palm of his hand.
And thank you both, and it is wonderful to hear an angel sing. Thank you. And play piano. All right. Next, we have the a poem by Luke Morrow, grandson-in-law. It's titled Remember Me.
Don't remember me with sadness. Don't remember me with tears. Remember all the laughter we've shared throughout the years. Now I am contented that my life, it was worthwhile. Knowing that I passed along the way, I made somebody smile. When you are walking down the street and you've got me on your mind, I'm walking in your footsteps, only half a step behind. So please, don't be unhappy just because I'm out of sight. Remember that I'm with you each morning, noon, and night.
Thank you, Blake. That was wonderful. Now we have Music, see, I'm in the right place. No, Prayer of the Faithful, Blake Anderson, grandson. Oh, there we go. All right.
Eternal rest unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May his soul and all the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Had I known it was going to be that quick, I wouldn't have sat down. Thank you very much, Blake. We now have another musical selection, which is going from Annie Haslam. And that is going to be Going Home, which will be a video. Is that correct? Okay.
Thank you.
Whoa, that was gorgeous. Is Annie Haslam here, or was this? No? Okay. Wow. I want to thank you all for being here today and let you know that there is going, the burial service will be at the Logan Cemetery. And there is a, the way to get there from here is drive north for 10 miles, then south for 80 miles, and take a left. Well, no, I'm sorry. The Logan Cemetery is over on 12th East, and the entrance, the main entrance, is the furthest gate, or the gate closest to 10th North. And the gravesite is right along the road. And Jim made the comment that this was a perfect plot, because you could drive right in the main gate. You could drive up to where the grave was, and you could open the window, toss a flower over on the gravesite, and go either hi Dad or hi Jim, and then drive right on out. And he thought that was that perfect placement. Perfect placement. So we will leave you with that. And it's does everybody know where the gravesite or the Logan Cemetery is? We can all get there. You are all welcome to come. And we look forward to seeing you there and in the future. Thank you all very, very much.